Thank you very much, the Lady of Ceremonies, Honorable Minister of Finance, other ministers of government, chairmen of state enterprise entities, board members, permanent secretaries, distinguished guests, all members of the media. Let me take this opportunity, first of all, in extending my best wishes for 2017 to all of you and your families. My wish is that you enjoy the best of health, you receive all God's blessings, and that you make this a very productive and satisfying year. I thought that I should start this symposium by emphasizing that we're here this morning, first of all, to underscore to all of you present that the government firmly believes that our state enterprise sector, particularly our wholly owned state enterprise sector, has a critical role to play in the supply of economic goods and services in Trinidad and Tobago. We also need to face the harsh reality that in general, too many of our state-owned enterprises have been underperforming, some much more than others. Some might even have deviated so far from their original purpose as to become the problem that they were created to solve. This government is committed to addressing the performance issues of all our state enterprises, those defaulting and others. We do so in part by reforming the way they are governed. In other words, we need to re-examine our corporate governance structures as they relate to the state enterprise sector. We recognize that this is a difficult task because it means addressing a host of complex issues. It is indeed likely that the government is part of the problem and that we need to examine how Parliament, ministers, and ministries interact with the state enterprises under their charge. We accept that there are legitimate questions, for example, as to whether some state enterprises have sufficient autonomy, or whether the roles and responsibilities of the state enterprise boards and the supervising ministries are sufficiently clear. While appropriate laws, regulations, and codes are needed, we are under no illusion that these are a panacea. For certain, the problem also involves attitudinal changes to our duties. It is against an understanding of this aspect of our challenges in this sector why only recently, after a cabinet caucus at a two-day retreat, the Minister of Finance has seen it fit and very necessary to issue a stern circular memorandum to all management and boards in the state enterprise sector that the timely submission of financial reports, whether audited or otherwise, is an uncompromising demand going forward. Government employees, as well as employees of state-owned corporations, must be committed to executing government policy and dedicated to serving the public by operating their businesses using best practice models. This objective includes proper oversight and reporting, as well as eliminating opportunities for waste, abuse, and corruption. The government is committed to making the state enterprise sector more efficient and certainly more effective. We believe that part of the solution rests with reforming the present governance model. We also believe that the reform process could benefit from a detailed and dispassionate analysis of what the main issues are. And we honestly want to hear your views. That, in short, is the main reason for this symposium. We acknowledge that many of you are volunteers doing yeoman service at your respective stations. But let us not forget that wherever we serve, we are first and foremost citizens of this country, and as such, we are all shareholders with equity in every investment of the state. For the younger ones among us today, I would like to give a brief overview of the evolution of the state-owned enterprise sector since independence 1962. During the 1960s, in the face of concern of the domination of our main economic sector by multinational corporations and stagnation and expansion in the range of economic activity, the government decided to take control and to grow the commanding heights of the economy, to use a very well-worn phrase. And in so doing, the public sector became more and more the prime mover of economic activity in our country. That is where you are now located as managers of the taxpayers' bounty, and in essence, you are the gatekeepers of the children's future. You fail, then we all fail. The government first became directly involved in utilities and transportation, telecommunications, then banking and finance, and the energy sector through its policy of localization. Thereafter, state-owned enterprises were created in the manufacturing and other sectors. As a result of this policy, between 1970 and 1985, the portfolio of state enterprise, which is state-owned, were more than doubled. As you know, the oil shock of the mid-1980s seriously reduced government's revenues, pretty much as it's happening now, and took a heavy toll on the government's finances and the economy in general. Thereafter, in the context of a structural transformation program in the 1980s, against the shadow of an IMF outing to the IMF and back, which took place in the 1980s, the government began to take steps to reduce the portfolio of state-owned enterprises as part of the process of fiscal consolidation. This led to the creation of a divestment secretariat which presided over the privatization or liquidation of several state-owned enterprises, many of which were in financial difficulty for one reason or the other, not the least of which were poor management, wasteful spending, and liberal doses of corruption. As government's fiscal position strengthened, based on higher oil prices and the growth of LNG exports, in 2004, the government began to create a new set of state-owned enterprises in order, ostensibly, to bring about improved implementation of the public sector investment program. And then we started hearing about special purpose state enterprises. And also to facilitate investment in the private sector with an expectation to foster development of particular industries identified as agents of diversification. And some of you might recall the outings at an earlier time into planting cassava and planting at Carony. These were supposed to be diversification efforts. And of course, there was the necessary, probably popular, but accepted and acceptably excursions into addressing some aspects of social policy with some of these programs and companies. This policy had brought us to our present situation, where today we have about 100 state enterprises and their subsidiaries. Not all of them necessary, and not all of them well run. In fact, quite a few of them could easily be departments of the establishment of ministries or as part of the private sector delivery. But they are part of the state enterprise sector, which has been reviewed fairly comprehensively by a group of people whose assignment has been done and has been submitted to the cabinet, and in the very near future, certain responses to that exercise will be forthcoming. Ladies and gentlemen, to put it mildly, performance of the state-owned enterprise sector has in many instances fallen far short of what was initially expected or anticipated. Most of the commercially oriented state-owned enterprises have accumulated significant losses, requiring large transfers of cash support from the central government. One may describe that as a burden on the taxpayer. May or may not be so in all instances, but at the end of the day, the exchequer account is the taxpayer's pocket. I trust that the Ministry of Finance would produce the raw numbers of this reality for your benefit and for that of the wider national community, because responses and reactions to what I'm saying now and the actions of the government going forward ought to be based on facts and figures and not feel so and think so. Additionally, state-owned enterprises have contracted, in some instances, very sizable debts which they have not been able to service, leaving the burden as permanent liabilities to the central government, and again, I may mention, to the taxpayer. Too many state enterprises have circumvented financial constraints by accumulating arrears, sometimes in a cavalier manner, and these arrears accumulated under the understanding that is for the government or other state-owned enterprises, particularly in the public utility sector. They're subscribing to the dubious principle of away with good accounting practices, away with best practice, is masabul masakau. And then you end up with the accounting entanglements which have resulted in nothing short of a financial mess among some major state enterprise sectors and their accounts with each other. There are many instances of weak project planning, questionable procurement practices, poor financial procedures and management practices as well. And these are all too prevalent in the sector. And as I mentioned earlier, late reporting or no reporting at all. And this includes submission of financial accounts, which sometimes are on the way to the parliament or to the ministry and arrive long after the administration is out of office or long after the parliamentary term has ended. And as if to add insult to injury, the sector is often accused of poor service delivery, which leads to widespread public discontent and general national cynicism. There are several pieces of legislation and other initiatives that seek to raise the performance of the state enterprise sector. On the legislative side, there's the Companies Act of 1995. There's the Integrity in Public Life Act of 2000. There's also the State Enterprise Performance Monitoring Manual, which provides a document framework for compliance with significant guidance for anticipated good governance and good corporate behavior. In addition, At the level of the parliament, there's the PAEC, the Public Accounts Enterprises Committee, which conducts hearings at which representatives of state enterprises and the line ministries are questioned on the financial and other matters of concern to the parliament. This is usually done on live television and affords the public an unfiltered view of how their business is being run, or should I say, ruined in some instances. As this process grows and continues to inform public appreciation, I feel some personal pride and satisfaction as the chairman of the parliamentary committee which recommended the live broadcasting of proceedings of debates in the House. Because this, I think, is one way of addressing this whole question of monitoring by national eyes of the public and reporting by those who are in charge to those who should monitor. And as this process continues, we expect that the national information base would widen, the national members and national community will be better informed of what is happening, and would take stands and comment appropriately on what they've seen and heard and learned from the presentation of their business to them by those who run their business. The legislative and other codes in particular, the monitoring manual, outline minimum standards, even though these may fall short of best practices. They would significantly raise performance standards if they are rigorously observed and, I dare say, enforced. The fact is, as a general rule, they are not largely enforced, and maybe in many instances not observed. It is worth noting that many large and important state enterprises have not produced audited financial statements for over 5 years. I want to repeat that. To managers whose major assignment is to report to the shareholder for the last set of resources you received in the last fiscal year. I want to repeat this, that a number of major state enterprises have not produced audited financial statements for over 5 years, and that under 15% of all state-owned enterprises submit their audited financial statements in the stipulated period. I want to repeat that. Under 15% of state enterprise companies submit their audited financial statements within the stipulated time frame. In some instances, they are in breach, even where the law demands that such statements are to be provided within specific time frames. This is a wholly unsatisfactory state of affairs. It opens the door for the putting under the carpet of wrongdoing. It reduces the effect of monitoring. It reduces the ability of the agency to borrow and spend in an organized and best practice manner. And it certainly does not augur well for the development of a proper management culture of those who manage in this way. And that being so, it pollutes the incoming environment as we attempt the meager succession planning that may exist in the state enterprise sector. So therefore, this is a good place to start. Today I want to accept as positive that as a general rule, poor governance always guarantees poor performance. While I have no intention to go through the performance manual, I would like to allocate the last few minutes of this opening presentation to identify some of the broad principles that we need to adopt if we are to have a quantum improvement in institutional governance in our state enterprise sector. The experts will tell you that in the state enterprise sector, good governance starts with a clear definition of the respective roles of the major players, the minister, and by extension, the ministry, which he or she may be managing, the board of the enterprise, and the management in the business. The role of the minister and the ministry is to define the main objectives of the enterprise and to make the board and management be accountable for achieving these objectives. The minister, and by extension the ministry, should also ensure that there are clear processes and criteria for assessing and evaluating performance in a timely fashion, and that there be responses to concerns as they are observed to arise, or even incipient concerns as they are discovered to be on their way up. Obviously, it is important to ensure that the board has been selected, that has been selected, is up to the task. That is why our government has been taking special steps to ensure that board members possess the appropriate balance of skills and competencies, along with the highest standards of integrity. We require our boards to have respect for value for money and to be guided by principles of fairness, transparency, and accountability. The boards have the onerous but necessary duty to recruit and train good management, to support such management, including succession planning, and to remove deadwood and obstructionists according to the tenets of good industrial relations. The board must be given sufficient autonomy and space to deliver the stated objectives within the laws and regulations that govern the state enterprise in which they perform. For its part, however, the board should focus as much as possible on strategic issues rather than on the day-to-day running of the enterprise. That should be left to the management, which should be held accountable at all times. It is important to note that a board appointment is an opportunity to serve the wider national community. It is work. It is not a status symbol. It is your commitment to giving back. And as I look at this gathering here this morning, I'm impressed. I'm proud. And I have a good feeling that something good is going to happen. The board's commitment to doing its work is what will keep management appropriately focused. It's the board's duty to ensure that management follows the rules and respects good corporate practices. Accordingly, boards should insist that management institute effective internal controls, transparent procurement systems, which in a few weeks' time would be required by law, and of course, be responsible for disclosure policies. The State Enterprise Performing Monitoring Manual, with which you all should and must be familiar, mandates the establishment of audit committees to assess the effectiveness of internal controls. Read it, then follow it, and you'll be on the right track. Under the provisions of the Exchequer and Audit Act, the Minister of Finance, as corporation sole, has responsibility for monitoring the financial performance of all state-owned enterprises covered by the Companies Act. The Performance Monitoring Manual also mandates that state enterprises submit certain specified information on a timely basis to the investment division of the Ministry of Finance. Many enterprises have not been abiding by this requirement. This will no longer be tolerated. The Ministry of Finance has been instructed to insist that state enterprises comply with this obligation. There will be consequences for non-compliance. Ladies and gentlemen, it's no secret that over the last 2 years or so, our economy has been going through a very difficult period, caused for the most part by the dramatic fall in energy prices. The revenue squeeze has meant that the central government has had to exercise very tight control on government spending. You, as directors and managers of the state enterprise sector, cannot be unmindful of the macroeconomic situation. Current fiscal realities demand that you treat responsibly with all the resources of your various institutions by carefully reviewing their spending plans, taking a stand against waste, overspending, and corruption, and insisting at all times on value for money. Your shareholders, the taxpayers, expect nothing less of you, board and management. It is worth repeating that improved governance will inevitably lead to enhanced operational performance. You as directors owe that to your ultimate shareholder, the people of Trinidad and Tobago. I want to specifically take this opportunity to thank all of you for agreeing to serve. And we all look forward to dramatic improvements in the performance of the state enterprise sector as you put your very considerable professionalism to work for the children of Trinidad and Tobago and for the future of our nation. Thank you very much. Thank you very sincerely for your attention, and thank you for agreeing to serve.